to another edition of Coastline, where we tell you what's going on around the Lowcountry. And today we're talking to J.W. Weatherford. He is the new park ranger at Hunting Island State Park, and it's good to have you with us, J.W.
Thank you very much. Happy to be here.
You are a recent addition to the Lowcountry, and they gave you the job. You applied for it. You had formerly been up at Murrells Inlet and then in Fairfax County, and decided you'd love to live here in the Lowcountry, put in your application, and no sooner did you put in your application that Hurricane Irma hit, and now you were supposed to come down here to take care of post-Matthew problems, and now you're dealing with a double cleanup, right?
That's right. Yeah, I had anticipated hopefully getting the position to be the cleanup park manager for Hurricane Matthew, and during the interview process, Hurricane Irma came, and so not much change other than the name of the storms that I would be cleaning up after.
As a matter of fact, the real work on cleaning up post-Matthew hadn't even begun, just because it takes over a year to get everything processed in terms of FEMA and other regulatory agencies. And so have you done anything yet in terms of trying to add some sand? I guess that's the biggest issue right now, is beach renourishment.
Yeah, that's the thing that if I could wave a magic wand and make happen right now, it would be we need sand. Sand dunes, sand on the beach, that's the defense. That's the only defense we have from storms, even from just the normal full moon, new moon, king spring tides. The sand dunes are a defense. And after Hurricane Matthew, we had 9-foot storm surges. And so that really wiped out our dune system. And so that's one thing that we're really looking forward to hearing by the end of this month or the beginning of November is to find out about the beach renourishment permit that we've requested.
Mm-hmm. One of the things that has been put in place in years past is something called groins out however many feet away from the coastline. Mm-hmm. Is that really intended mostly for your typical and average erosion, not really intended to help in the case of a major storm?
Yeah, that's right. So the groins, you know, our focus with the groins is to try to keep as much beach as possible. And when, you know, the state invests in beach renourishment, you want to try to keep that sand as long as you can. And so that's the goal behind the groins, is to try to help us keep sand as long as we can from you know, areas that have high erosion problems.
Why does Hunting Island seem to have a higher than normal erosion problem? It seems like you know, putting sand back on the beach is like rearranging the decks on the Titanic, because you know it's going to end up needing it again in a few years.
That's right. One thing that has been very interesting to me to learn in this position in the, you know, the month I've been at Hunting Island is I'm a history major, and so I've gone back and looked at a lot of the histories of the beach renourishments and really a lot of the pictures. And I've gone back over, you know, 100 years, seen pictures of over 100 years of what the coastline looked like from Fripp and Hunting Island and Harbor. And the beach has really, really changed. I mean, just dramatically. And, you know, so I don't think it's anything that's new, but those barrier islands, you know, that's kind of what they do. They defend the interior part of the coast. And so that's what they do. They kind of ebb and flow, and sand will, you know, be taken from a south area of the beach and put further up on the north end of the beach, and then, you know, 30 years later, it may switch course, and so
there
really
is sometimes a reversal.
Right, mm-hmm. Right.
Okay. How did, I know this is not part of your purview, but just for our information, how did Fripp weather both Matthew and Irma?
I really don't know. I haven't, you know, like I said, I've only lived here for a month, and we don't have very many members on the Friends of Hunting Island, which is kind of our nonprofit organization. There aren't many people that live and reside at Fripp Island that I've met. So I really haven't heard a lot about really damage to really much Fripp or Harbor. I've really been, you know, focused.
Yeah, understandably.
Six and a half days a week on Hunting Island. Yeah.
Well, that's a real shame. And aside from the fact that you're having to deal with the beach renourishment and all that involves, and we're going to get back to that in a second, but you're having to deal with standing water now, because the problem, as I understand from what you said earlier before we started taping, is that your big problem with Irma was not so much the winds, but the water. And now you've got pools all over the place?
That's right. So Hurricane Matthew was, for us, was the storm of wind. We lost over 2,000 trees just in the day use areas of the park. So in the public areas of the park, we have had to remove over 2,000 trees. And one thing, if you think about what trees do, the nutrients they get comes from water that they suck up, you know, that filter through the tree. And so that's, you know, there's 2,000 water filters that are gone.
Oh, right.
From Matthew. And so now that that Irma came in, that wasn't nearly the windstorm for us. It was, you know, we didn't have a sand dune system. And most of the trees that could have come down in public areas were down from Matthew. And so really the problem that we had from Irma was water, lots and lots of water. This picture we're showing is the main road coming in off of Highway 21. And that's neat.
Is that still like that?
No. We're open now, and so cars drive past this every day. Mm-hmm. But that was immediately after Irma. So that was 9 feet. Mm. I mean, that was knee-deep water to the main entrance at Highway 21. Mm-hmm. And so now that's water is our issue. That's why our trails system is still closed. That's one thing I've really been wanting to focus on. You know, is trying to get those trails open as soon as we can. This is part of our campground here, and that's the road that campers, that's a very wide two-lane road with campsites over on this side. And that's the problem is we just don't have any way to get the water going. We can't pump water into the ocean. We can't pump water into the salt marsh. The water is not evaporating. We, you know, have lost over 2,000 trees, and we're probably going to lose around 400 trees in the campground in this area. All these pines that you see have salt incursion, which means they've been standing in salt water and have sucked, you know, have filtered.
They're gonna be
dead. Right, so they're gonna die. So we're gonna lose about 400 trees from Irma, but not from wind, it's from water. And so that's really the as the annals of state park history is gonna go for Hunting Island, the damage from Irma is gonna come from water. And the recovery from Irma is going to be finding out how to remove the water.
Yeah. So you said you can't pump the water out into the ocean. Is that because it's against the law?
Right. Yeah, there are DHEC regulations on where you can pump, especially stagnant, standing salt water. And so there have been a lot of things we've, you know, thought about trying to maybe get some engineers long term to figure out a water plan for us, whether that be retention ponds or more drain ditches cut through the park. So those are long-term plans for what we're going to do with the water. But right now, our focus is to get as much of the park open as we can. And so today we have 50% of the park open, the day use North Beach Park where the historic lighthouse is and the beach access. And that was our main focus, was getting beach access to the public, to the locals, and to the lovers in general of Hunting Island. You know, it has been really interesting to me being here for a month to see tags from California, Ontario, Wisconsin, California, you know, New York, all over the place. Mm-hmm. Car tags, people driving here.
Right.
And so that's been something that's really interesting to see, the people that are just in love and so passionate about Hunting Island. So that's why our focus has really been to try to get beach access and access to the lighthouse. The nature center is open.
It is.
So two of our main attractions at the park are open. Now our focus is on the campground to try to hopefully get campers here by the beginning of the year.
Okay, and of course, one of the big attractions in years past had been the villas that you could actually rent, which you're now down to one. At the largest you ever had was 50, but over time and erosion and winds and just decay, you've gone down to this last one. Do you have any plans to maybe rebuild some of those areas?
Yeah, we would love to, again, in long-term planning, we would love to add 10 or so cabins to the park. But again, you know, like I say, that's long-term planning. And right now our main focus is the campground. Then once we get the campground open, then we still have South Beach access to get open. And that, what I have come to understand, is a lot of locals, that's the part of the park that they really loved, was South Beach. Because a lot of the tourists, which you can understand, go to the North Beach where the lighthouse is, because that's really the tourist kind of destination. The draw is North Beach. And so that's really our plan now, is to get campground open for campers and then focus all our work on the South Beach. And that, as a new park manager, that's what I have been doing, is really funneling all work into specific areas so that we're not spread out over 5,000 acres trying to clean up after two hurricanes in 11 months. Our focus has been get the day use beach area open, get the lighthouse open, get access to visitors to the beach and to the lighthouse, which we've done, and so the Nature Center and Lighthouse open. And so now we've moved our attention to really focusing on the campground so that we can try to get those 100 campsites open. And when we get open at the beginning of the year, we'll refocus to the South Beach.
Okay, sounds good. And you had mentioned the Friends of Hunting Island. Tell us about what that group is, and is it open to the public, or how does that work?
So the Friends of Hunting Island is our nonprofit 501c3 group for Hunting Island, and they are just a dynamic resource that not all state parks have. It's something that they're a group that can go out and get grants that just a state agency, you know, may not be able to get. They do fundraisers all throughout the year. They are instrumental in our sea turtle program, conservation program, and protecting our sea turtle nest and inventorying the sea turtle eggs throughout the year. And so they are instrumental in having Hunting Island be the park that people know it to be. They have over 1,000 members. Mm-hmm. And so without the help that Friends of Hunting Island gives to Hunting Island State Park, it would be managed very differently. Mm-hmm. And so they are just a dynamic group of people that are passionate. They work hard, they plan, you know, they do fundraisers, and you know, right now they're just chomping at the bits now that the park is back open to do what they can do to help out as much as they can. And so that's what I would say to the people that are passionate and that want to find out how they can help. I would direct them to the Friends of Hunting Island.
Okay.
They have a Facebook page that is very interactive.
Okay. So if I go to Facebook and just type in
Friends of Hunting Island,
I'll be good there. Yeah. All right. J.W. Weatherford, the new park ranger, welcome to the Lowcountry and to your job security for the next several years.
Thank you.
Good to have you there. And we're going to be talking in just a minute to representatives of the town of Hilton Head and talking about the Mitchellville Preservation Project as well as long-term visioning for the southern portion of Beaufort County. We hope you'll join us. And we're back with Ahmad Ward. He is the executive director of the Mitchellville Preservation Project. And we're going to find out all about Mitchellville. It's a very historic area. Good to have you with us, Ahmad.
My pleasure. Thanks for having me.
And you have, as your charge, the project of getting the word out and getting some funds in of the historic site known as Mitchellville. Tell us a little bit about Mitchellville, where it is, and why it is considered a historic site.
Sure thing. Well, Mitchellville is the first self-governed freedman town in America, right there on Hilton Head Island off Beach City Road. This was established in 1862 after the Battle of Port Royal. And of course, before the Emancipation Proclamation.
Oh, before the Emancipation.
Right, right. Okay. So of course, it had been worked on, but it wasn't presented to the rest of the country until January of 1863. Mm-hmm. So this is pre-emancipation as far as in terms of the history, mm-hmm. right? And so what happens is you have these newly freed black people who were liberated because of the Battle of Port Royal, mm-hmm. and Union Army comes in and takes over. And they start to follow Union Army, as was the case in the South, looking for work, because you had carpenters, you had blacksmiths, you had people with all these skills, mm-hmm. and looking to, you know, create their own lane and make a living for their families. And so what ends up happening is they try to create barracks and living conditions near the bases, but it just wasn't working out. And so General Ormsby Mitchell, who was an astronomer along with being the general, decides to make a decision here and give them the first chance to enjoy freedom. Mm. There's the old Drayton plantation that was near the area, and he gives them that property. We're talking roughly around 32 acres, mm-hmm. Is connected with the existing base, and says, this is your land, you build it, you till it, you know, create your own rules, create your laws, and that's what happened. So the important thing about Mitchellville is what happens when people are able to actually see opportunity,
right.
and act on it. Mm-hmm. This is the first chance of citizenship, first chance for democracy. And so they flourished. Not only did they build the town, they created their laws, they elected a mayor, they had a council, and what we believe is the first compulsory education system in South Carolina and potentially the state, of essentially the South, excuse me. So if you were anywhere from between 6 and 15 years old and living in Mitchellville, you had to go to school. Mm-hmm. And so we're trying to play off this important history. This is something that goes beyond African American history. This is American history.
Sure.
And gives us the first taste of what freedom was supposed to look like during Reconstruction.
And how many people originally were residents of this newly found area called Mitchellville?
Well, at the height, based on history, we're looking at anywhere between 1,500 and 3,000 people.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, it was not a small community.
So, and these folks were, by and large, brought from neighboring plantations and other areas in South Carolina, or did they?
They came.
They came from all over the country.
They came. I think the initial influx in December of 1862 was about 320 people, mm-hmm. but then word gets out and people come on.
Sure.
And so what ends up happening here is people hear about Mitchellville, of course, word of mouth. But then you have situations like the Comanche Ferry Raid, where Harriet Tubman came in and helped free about 800 slaves.
Right.
She personally brought about 100 of those to Mitchellville. Mm-hmm. And a lot of them stayed, a lot of them joined the Union Army. And so it became a template for how all freedmen towns were supposed to look. So this is the rehearsal of Reconstruction.
Yeah.
People talk about the Port Royal experiment, and they don't really mention Mitchellville. Mm. Mitchellville is the template. Mm-hmm. Because it was actually working. And you got about 19 years, roughly, of a successful, thriving town, which doesn't die. They just move to other parts of the island because it became more expedient for them to do so, mm-hmm. for economics.
How was this received by the people that may have been former slave owners and folks that lived in the area that may have been against the abolition of slavery in the South? Was there anger that was expressed through all of this?
Not well.
Not well.
You can imagine people who owned slaves now seeing people use their property. It wouldn't go over well. Mm-hmm. And we got to say, even though the Union Army provided an opportunity, the relationship between these people and the Union Army was not, you know, peaches and cream. There were some issues that happened there as well, because you still had Union soldiers who would either try to sell people back toward their owners, or yes, you had that kind of thing happen.
Really?
Yes, which is not uncommon. Or really not appreciate the fact that you had people on the same level, which were their property just a few weeks before. Mm-hmm. But even with all that, these people saw fit to create a situation for themselves that was really lined up with the American dream. Mm-hmm. And that's why, you know, it's problematic that nobody knows about Mitchellville, for real. You know, I came into this, I've only been here about 5 months myself. Mm-hmm. And the fact that I didn't know about Mitchellville before I got here as a history person
speaks
mind-boggling.
Yeah.
Right, you know, mm-hmm. and so we're trying to make sure that gets changed, because this is a feel-good story in the middle of one of the nation's horrors,
sure.
right?
Mm-hmm.
You know, this is something that people don't feel comfortable talking about. Anytime slavery comes up, people feel a certain way about it because it's not something that's warm and fuzzy, obviously, mm-hmm. right? It's a hard topic to deal with. But in the middle of all that, you have this determination story. You have this situation where people were able to do what folks think they couldn't do because mm-hmm. they believed them to be inferior, and they proved them wrong. Mm-hmm. And it's a good story that needs to be told, not just in Beaufort County, but the state and the nation. So that's what we're really tasked with doing, is making sure everybody knows about Mitchellville and eventually have somewhere for them to come and visit.
When the General Mitchell allowed this settlement to be populated, was any federal funding offered to help start some of the infrastructure, the governmental infrastructure?
Yes and no. He did give the full weight of what they were already had on the base. You got to remember, when they took over Hilton Head, this was the largest Union base in the South. Okay, it became the Department of the Army's southern structure. This was where everything happened. And so what he did was told the sawmills that they already had to build, to push more lumber, to get more resources, and they gave them to these people mm-hmm. so they can build. And they lined it up with the Army Corps of Engineers grid that was already in place. And so you got this same kind of structure in Mitchellville that you had at the Union Army base. Mm-hmm. So to that end, resources were set forth. But they worked they really work to get their stuff. And so besides selling food and wares and things of that nature, they did business with the Union Army soldiers.
Okay.
And with the Union Army itself. And so you had this synergy where you had the war effort going on, and you had this population that was really helping to do the little things that needed to be done to make sure that it functioned well. Mm-hmm. So it was a match made in heaven, honestly, until 1868 when the Union Army leaves. Mm-hmm. And that kind of trips the town up a little bit. But they are able to keep going for another 15 years or so, okay. Almost.
What were they doing after the Army left in terms of trade and?
Well, going further places.
Okay.
Going further into the island. Mm-hmm. Robbers Row, which you may be familiar with. Selling, building, doing their things, and operating a cohesive community unit with themselves. Mm-hmm. So there was purchasing happening right there. They were really trying to do self-contained economics in that area. And after a while, it just became something that couldn't last. And so instead of dying out, they picked up their stuff and moved in.
Moved in further inland?
Further inland to the island, yes.
Which is unfortunate, because if they'd stood their ground a little longer, they would have probably had some great property to sell. Where is it located in relation to the island?
Well, if you know the island is built like a shoe, mm-hmm. It'd be the back of the hill.
Okay. Right on the ocean.
Right on
the ocean. Oh my goodness.
Now, one of the things that happens though, when Johnson takes power as president.
Lyndon?
Andrew. You gotta go way back. They begin to sell that property back to the previous owners.
Oh.
And so that's what really happens.
Oh.
And so the rug is pulled out from under people. Mm. And at one point, Hilton Head Island boasted about 3,000 people. About 2,200 of those folks were African American. Mm-hmm. But by 1930, you only had about 350 people on the island, and they were all developers for the most part.
And let me guess, the residents didn't get top dollar for their property.
Oh, of course not.
Of course not. Well, that's just part of the story, and that's the reason that you are there, to help tell that story and to get the word out to the rest of the country. If people would like more information or would like to help out with the Mitchellville Preservation Project, who can they contact?
Well, they can, of course, contact us at our offices, and that's 843-255-7301. But exploremitchellville.org is the place to get most of your information. And I got to say this, Mitchell has one L, so exploremitchellville.org with one L, else you won't get to us.
Okay.
And right now, this is our 155th anniversary of Mitchellville. So we have an end-of-the-year campaign, which you see right here. 155 years, 155 donors, $155. Of course, we'd love to have more than 155 donors. Mm-hmm. But it's a way to support 2018 programming by giving in honor of the anniversary of this town as we begin to build this thing and build a master plan, and hopefully sometime soon have a park where young people and people who are young at heart can visit and learn more about this important community.
That'll be great. Thanks so much. Ahmad Ward, Executive Director of the Mitchellville Mitchellville
right.
Preservation Project. And again, we thank you so much and look
My
forward
pleasure.
To you getting the word out.
Thank you, sir.
We're going to be talking about what's happening in the future of Hilton Head right after this. And we're back with Emily Sparks, who is with the town of Hilton Head Island, and she is a project lead. The project, you may ask, is what? It is their visioning project. Tell us a little bit about what the visioning project is, Emily.
Absolutely. Well, the town's visioning project is the long-range planning initiative that the town council set out on, and the goal really is to ensure that all residents, local businesses, institutions, and all stakeholders have a voice in planning for and shaping the future of the island.
Mm-hmm. And is this a mandated by law that a town needs to do this?
This particular one isn't. This is about, you know, the town deciding it was a good idea to, you know, let's think ahead, let's think mm-hmm. towards the future so that we can be prepared for what's coming and make strategic decisions based on, you know, what the people that live on, work on, and care about Hilton Head.
And how far out are you looking? How many years down the road?
We're looking out to 2040.
Okay.
So we're looking quite a way out, and we've had a lot of engagement already. We've had, you know, about 1,000 residents be a part of this process and talk about what type of future they want to see on the island.
All right. And you've had some feedback already. What are you hearing? Are you hearing More development? Probably not. Not from the existing folks. More food, restaurants, and entertainment? Or are they seeking that, you know, we now close the gates to Hilton Head Island and don't let anybody else in?
We have heard everything you just said. So we're hearing all kinds of things, but what's important is that we're hearing from people, really. You know, this process started with a lot of research and, you know, benchmarking, all of those type of things. We moved into a think tank where we spent an entire day with 150 people and talked about all the things you just mentioned. And then we went out into the community. And so for the last couple of months, we've been holding a series of engagement workshops. And we've heard all manner of things, but what's important is that we are hearing from people, and we'll have more opportunities, the most exciting of which is coming up. If people missed the in-person engagement workshops, we're going to be offering virtual engagement workshops.
Mm, so, that means that they'll be able to get on their iPads or their computers.
Right.
And be part of a webinar?
Right, from the comfort of home.
Okay.
You know, so we know there are a lot of second homeowners or people that may travel a lot, have busy schedules with their children, and maybe they couldn't come out to one of the, you know, 20 or so workshops we had, but and that's okay. So we're going to offer an opportunity to be a part of the process virtually.
Okay, so this is the process here.
That's exactly
and
right.
We've already done the community engagement. We're now in the month of November, so you get a little bit of a break, an opportunity to kind of coalesce everything. What happens in December now?
So in December, we'll be bringing the think tank together again. So that group of 150 people that I mentioned, they'll come back together and we'll say, you know, here's what we've been hearing in these other workshops. We'll go out and meet with other stakeholders to kind of refine what we're hearing, to, you know, test out what it is that we're hearing. And then, you know, we'll go back into January and February to actually define the action plans. And so this vision, when it's complete, the community vision will have 3 and 5 year benchmarks. You know, so there will be, you know, a defined plan for us to get where we want to be in 2040.
Okay, and everything will come to an end in January and February, and then will anything come out of this study? Will you actually be able to do something, or is just this a study for study's purposes?
No, the goal is not to put this on the shelf. The goal is to, you know, have something that is actionable, and that's why there will be, you know, steps and milestones for us to reach. So we'll be really excited to bring it out into the public and, you know, talk as a community about how we can get where we want to be.
Okay. If anybody would like to talk to you personally, if they didn't have an opportunity to, you know, be part of the engagement process or would like more information about the webinar type engagement you're going to be having next month, where can they reach you?
The town's website. All of our contact information is there. The project has its own website, which you can reach right there from the homepage of the Town of Hilton Head's website. And you could also subscribe to the email newsletters, and that's the best way to get information.
Okay. Well, thank you, Emily Sparks. We appreciate your bringing us an update on the town's visioning process. And that's this edition of Coastline. Lots of things to talk about, and we hope you'll join us again next month when we'll have more exciting guests.